that anyhow, but Ephesians 2:6. I want to show you this. This is talking about a position that we have in Christ. Watch this. This is right now. This is not when we die and go to heaven. This is right now. Okay? And hath raised us up together, talking about Jesus and us, and made us to sit together in heavenly places in Christ. Colossians 3, verse 1 says, if you be risen with Christ, seek those things which are above, where Christ sitteth on the right hand of the Father. Set your affection, your mind on things above, not on things of this earth. For you're dead and your life is hid with Christ in God. When Christ, who is our life, shall appear, then shall you also appear with him in glory. But what's powerful about that is this is talking about our position in Christ. And I put my water bottle up here because it's so nice. No, I'm kidding. And I said this last week, I think, and the week before, but man, I started seeing it. I was praying and I was seeing fear and different things that try to come at you, me and at you. And I was thinking, where this water is in the bottle. Wherever this bottle goes, the water goes. Now, if this bottle speaks of Christ and Christ is raised and I've been raised, that's my position. But if my understanding is still down here on the earth, where is fear at? Is it where he's at or is it on the earth? It's everywhere on the earth. This is why it's so important to set your affection, your mind on things above, not on things of this earth. Fear is torture. Amen? And that's what it says. It says perfect love or mature love or an understanding of love. Cast out fear because fear has torment. He that fears has not been perfected in love. He's not understood the love of God for him. Love is a covenant term. Did you know that? Agape is something unique to God. Amen. Praise God. Well, we're going to get into this. And I've entitled this, man, this is part two of Blood Covenant. Trust me, you don't want to miss this. I'm not kidding you. This is so big. It's the whole Bible. The whole Bible. If you and I don't understand that God only relates to us through covenant. I shared this last week. I'm going to share it again. 1 Chronicles 16:15. We may go back there because I'm going to show you this. We're going to talk about the sure mercies of David. I don't know where we'll all get today, but we'll get to some of this. and I've rolled a lot of it over because it's so big. It's so big. If you understand that God relates to you by covenant, do you know you have a hold on God? Did you know that? But God loves it. He set it up that way. Amen? No amens. Where's mom when I need her? Be mindful always of his covenant. This is David talking. The word which he commanded to 1,000 generations. Now, the Lord showed me I could preach 2 weeks just on 1,000. The significance of that is so big. Listen, guys, don't think you understand the Bible. That's called deception. Doesn't mean you don't have some information, but don't stay there. It's layers upon layers, and it's amazingly good. And it's not just what I believe in my head, it's what my heart's saying. See, that's not where I can tell where my understanding's at. When I see all these fears dominate me, I think, I don't know what I think I know. I'm not condemned by it. I'm encouraged. Praise God. He's saying, come up hither. I got more for you, man. Let me see what I've done for you. Amen. Be mindful. Listen, we are commanded. This is David. This is not Mosaic law of it. This is David saying, be mindful always of the covenant. Now, one more since we're there. Deuteronomy 7, verse 9. Watch this. These are so powerful. So powerful. We got a better covenant based upon better promises because of we've got Jesus. Amen? But God always relates to man through covenant. He does not and cannot relate to you and I outside of covenant. That's why this teaching that, well, God just did that to you because he's trying to teach you something is demonic. It's demonic. I'm telling you, it's Satan. You want to know what Satan looks like in the body? That's one of the ways he looks like. That's a big way, because I'm telling you, if you believe that, then you're basically saying, no, God moves outside of covenant because he really likes Arthur. No, God loves Arthur, but God only works through covenant. He cannot work any other way. That's why David was saying, be mindful always. How often? Always of the covenant. Now watch this. Know therefore that the Lord thy God, he is a faithful God. He's a faithful God to do what? Good or bad? He's faithful to do good. God is faithful. You got to know that. I got to know that. Watch this. Which keepeth covenant and... Now that's a weak word. Weak word. You know, and I've said this and it's true. It's not incorrect. It's just incomplete. Mercy's not getting judgment we deserve. That's true. Grace is getting the goodness we don't deserve. That's true also. But that's a weak word. And we're going to spend... I mean, it is packed. I'm going to get into the Hebrew word hasid. It literally means covenant loyalty. Covenant loyalty. The Hebrew word hasid means covenant loyalty. He keeps covenant and covenant loyalty with them. Now we're getting into law. With them that love him and keep his commandments. There it is again, to 1,000 generations. Does this not apply anymore? Wrong, it does apply. It absolutely applies. But we understand everything in the context of the new covenant. And you'll see that. Everything in the Bible's for us. Everything. But you have to understand it through the filter of the cross and what Jesus did. We're on this side of the cross, not that side. Jesus said, if you love me, John 15:14, keep my commandments. Oh, there it is again, the 613 laws of the old covenant. That's not what he's saying. You know the covenant that Jesus is a product of is the covenant of Abraham? Did you know that? Do you know why God gave the law? The Bible says in Galatians 3:19, the law was added because of transgressions. Added to what? I'm making you think, I hope. Hope I'm not making you sleep. I looked up the word added to make sure it was added. And it's added. In the Greek, it means added. The law was added. Anybody know? To the Abrahamic covenant. God had to add the law to protect the promises until the seed, which is Jesus Christ, could come. Whew. My word, that's good. See, anything we preach, I said this last week, anything we proclaim, whether it's faith, whether it's prayer, whatever it is, without a covenant understanding leads to presumption every time. If I preach faith, okay, faith, bless God, just have faith. I'm either going to the restroom or I'm trying to have faith. Right? We don't even know what it is. Faith in Jesus, brother. Yeah, what is that? Who is that? What does that mean? It's the covenant God. Andrew Murray said, he lived way back in the 18th century, went home to heaven in 1917 from the Cape of South Africa. He said back then, a word that's almost obsolete today is the word covenant. That's in his day. See, this is why, and I said this, I'm going to keep saying this. This is why God grieves over the death of the wicked. Number one, because he loves the wicked. But number two, because he cannot do anything about it when they're going to hell because they've rejected his covenant. Even the land mourns. We looked at that last week. You got to know, therefore, the Lord thy God, he is God, the faithful God. He keeps covenant and covenant loyalty, hasid, with them that love him and keep his commandments to 1,000 generations. And we are going to do a message on 1,000 tonight. And you're going to see how powerful that word. That's a symbolic number. That's not talking about 1,000 and then God owns the cattle on 1,000 hills and that 1,000 and first hill, he don't own that cow or that hill. That's not what that's saying. The word 1,000 is powerful. And the answer, you know where it's at? In the word. It's not on Google. Hallelujah. One more. Okay, one more. Then we'll get in the outline. See, we're taking our time, believe it or not. I'm not rushing this. Alan Gerling gave me that advice, and I thought, you know what? That's God. I know, Patty. Now you know. No, I'm just kidding. Patty's his wife, in case you don't know. Isaiah 55, we'll just look at verse 2 and 3. Wherefore... Or why? Wherefore do you spend your money for that which is not bread? And your labor for that which satisfies not? Hearken diligently unto me, and eat that which is good. Leave this up here. And let your soul delight itself in obesity. Fatness. It's the Hebrew word deshen, D-E-S-H-E-N, and it means it's literally the ashes of an offering. It speaks of a finished work. Amen? Let your soul delight itself in a finished work. Next verse. Incline your ear and come unto me. Hear, and your soul shall live. Hear what? Take this monster. I should have turned it down. I get these news flashes, you know, President Trump combed his hair today. Incline your ear and come unto me. Hear, and your soul shall live. Now watch this. It says, hear, and my soul shall live. The flip side of it is, if I don't hear, my soul won't live. This is the message we're getting to today, called freedom from the morgue of the living dead. You know, there's a lot of people walking around and they're physically alive, but they're the living dead. There's no life. There's a difference between living and existing. God wants us to live the same quality of life that God's enjoying. Now listen, I realize we're in a mortal body. Mortal means death doomed, even though it's blessed. I told a guy the other day, I said, boy, we're all wrestling with the second law of thermodynamics. Order going to disorder. It's a fight. We're in a broken world. The whole world lies in wickedness. Amen? And by the way, Dan, the Lord showed me exactly why intelligent people can believe evolution. You know why? They have a skewed view of God. And when your view of God's skewed, you're open to deception. Incline your ear and come unto me. Hear, and your soul shall live. Hear what? And I will make an everlasting covenant with you. An everlasting covenant with you. Covenants cannot be broke. Even the sure mercies of David. Now, the sure mercies of David are spoken of another place in the New Testament. Acts 13:34 speaks of the sure mercies of David. Once again, circle that on the screen if you would. Mercies is that Hebrew word hasid. It's covenant loyalty. Covenant loyalty. One more. I know I said one more. I'm not real good at counting. I didn't excel in that class. The Lord spoke, I'm driving, minding my own business, praying in the Holy Ghost, not bothering anybody. And I'm listening to Pastor Jerome Fernando, a worship CD that he's got. And he, at the end, he goes, I want to pray for you. He's from Sri Lanka. I love him. And he's praying, and he goes, and here's the key of, and he said, he just said this, the key of David. And I went, the Holy Ghost just exploded on the inside of me. I saw the key of David. I know what it is. I used to think I knew what it was. I used to think, the key of David, he's a worshiper and a praiser, and he certainly was. But that's not the key of David. That's not the key of David. Notice it's a key, not keys. Let me show it to you. Revelation 3:7. We're trying to get to the outline. We're going to. We are going to. Revelation 3:7. Watch this. What is the key of David? And to the angel of the church in Philadelphia write, these things saith, he that is holy, he that is true, he that has the key of David. Jesus has the key of David. Now watch this. He that opens, and no man can shut it. When the key of David opens a door for you, nobody can shut it. And watch this. And he shuts the wrong doors. And when he shuts a door, no one can open it. How many of you want those kind of doors? How many are tired of going in the wrong doors? I am. I've come to the conclusion I do not have time to waste. I love people. I love what Greg Moore said this. It really helped me. He said, I value everyone. They're all precious, but not everyone's worth my time. Because they don't want to change. And some of them are sent by the enemy to steal your time. Can I give you some advice? Show me your friends and I'll show you your future. Wait till we get into friends. That's another covenant word. I'm telling you, who you hang with, if they're not excited about the Lord and they're not pulling you up, I'm talking about your friends, not the people you're ministering to. But even them, pull them up. See, I've discovered a lot of counseling isn't really counseling. It's just people wanting you to agree with their stand. Just agree with me. And you're a great counselor. I'm not going to agree with you. I only agree with him. And if you're agreeing with him, I'm in agreement. Look at this, the key of David. It opens and no man shuts and shuts and no man's open. Here's the key of David. Let me show it to you. 1 Samuel 17:26. We'll look at 36 and maybe verse 37. I'm going to show you. This is the key of David. Here it is. And David spake. This is when David was with Goliath, and his dad sent him out there to bring food to the army. David wasn't even called to the battle. And David and Goliath, the Philistine champion, spake to the men that, or David spake to the men that stood by him, saying, "What shall be done to the man that kills this Philistine and taketh away the reproach from Israel?" Israel's God's people. Do you know when things come against you, when sickness, and those are trying to reproach God's people? Poverty is a reproach upon God's people. Amen? Now watch this. "For who is this uncircumcised Philistine that he should defy the armies of Israel?" I said it last week. Who is this uncircumcised circumstance? Who is this uncircumcised person? Who is this? How dare they come against the children of God? Look at verse 36. This is when Saul was talking to King Saul and saying, "Hey man, do my armor and all that kind of stuff." Verse 36. Then David's rehearsing his past victories. Boy, there's so many good things here. We need to rehearse our past victories. But why did he have victory? The key of David. Well, I'll tell you what it is here. Thy servant slew both a lion and the bear. They were probably uncircumcised. And this uncircumcised Philistine shall be as one of them, seeing he hath defied the armies of the living God. The key of David is covenant consciousness. David was conscious that he had a covenant with God. When you and I are conscious that we don't have David's covenant, David yearned for our covenant. Did you know that? Did you know that? Psalm 32, Romans chapter 4. He envied. Let's look at Psalm 4. I want to show you this. This is David's Psalm 4. Romans 4, verse 8. Watch this. This is quoting from Psalm 32. This is David saying, "Blessed is the man." He's talking about you and I. "To whom the Lord will not impute sin." Next verse. Back up to verse 6. I want to get a running start here. Even as David also describes the blessedness of the man unto whom God imputeth righteousness without works. David said this. Now, David was conscious of his covenant, which was an inferior covenant to the one you and I have. How much more our covenant based upon the Lamb of God? See, listen to me. If you become covenant conscious, this cannot not work. It can't. The only reason it doesn't work is because we vacillate in believing it. Oh, glory to God. And this is not a formula. That's why I said you got to hear. "Cometh even a David," he describes the blessedness. Look at your neighbor and say, "I'm blessed." "Of the man unto whom God imputes righteousness without works." Next verse. Say, "I'm blessed, for my iniquities are forgiven, and my sins are covered," they're removed. Next verse. "Blessed is the man to whom God will not impute sin." That's us. Now think about it, the key of David, David's key. Why was David a man after God's own heart? Well, he just did things like God did. Well, yes, but that's not what that's saying. He was in covenant. Listen, where the bottle is, that's where the water is. Where Christ is, that's where I'm at. If I understand that. See, this is why understanding. Colossians 2, we hit it last week, verse 2. Watch this. Colossians 2, verse 2, talking about the saints, that their hearts might be comforted, being knit together in love. I could camp right there. When we get into the walk of covenant, we will realize how important we are to each other. People won't be so flippant in their relationships one with another. "I'm mad at you. That preacher looked at me wrong." Serious, we're ridiculous in those areas, because we don't have a clue about covenant. And then we wonder why the promises, we can't get them to work. They only work in covenant. Amen. "That their hearts might be comforted, being knit together in love." Another covenant word, agape. "And unto all the riches," all the riches "of the full assurance of understanding." Of understanding what? The new covenant. the new covenant. See, you know, even people that think, well, bless God, I'm not under the law, they're clueless as a goose in the fog when it comes to this stuff. As I said earlier, God only added the law to the Abrahamic covenant to secure, to protect the promises until the seed, which is Christ, should come. Galatians 3, he saith, not to seeds as of many, but as of one, even as Christ Jesus. And if you're in your Christ, and if you're in Christ, you're Abraham's seed and heirs according to the promise. Abraham had on credit, which you and I have in substance and reality. Amen. Glory to God. Watch the full assurance of understanding to the acknowledgement of the mystery and of God and of the Father in Christ. Next verse, in whom are hid all the treasures of wisdom and knowledge. That's where it's at. Now let's get into the outline. Praise God, that was good. First Corinthians, we did cover a couple of those verses. Oh man, look at number one. Outside of covenant understanding, believers will walk in the morgue of the living dead. Ephesians chapter 2. No. Ephesians 2, but I want to do verse 11 through 14. And we did these last week. This is review and new. I'm going to fly. Hang with me. Ephesians 2, verse 11. We looked at this last week. Wherefore remember, remember is covenant terminology. Remember, you know when it says God remembered? It wasn't like, oh, I forgot that one. That's not what it is. You're reminding him of something. Remember that ye being in the past Gentiles in the flesh, talking about natural lineage, who are called uncircumcision by that which is called the circumcision, the Jews in the flesh made by hands. Next verse. That at that time, under the old covenant, that at that time you were without Christ, being aliens from the commonwealth of Israel and strangers from the covenants of promise, having no hope and without God in the world. You know, there's a real attack on hope today. There's a real attack on hope. Next verse. But now, in Christ Jesus, ye who were sometimes afar off are made nigh by the blood of Christ. Next verse. For he is our peace. He is our peace with God. He is our peace with God. How many people walk around guilty all the time? I'm talking about born again children of God, and they're constantly feeling guilty. Many times. Well, I'm not what I should. The world makes you feel guilty. The world controls you with guilt. Amen? Hey, you better get this done or else. So we live our life just, you know, we're living in this realm. We're not doing anything out of peace because we don't get it. God's not mad at me. His wrath was taken out on Jesus at the cross. Come back. We're going to come back right here, right? Isaiah 54. Watch this. Verse 7. We're coming right back. We're going to do this justice. I mean, if we get this far on the outline, we'll roll it, we'll mix it, we'll do it. I mean, it's so good. But this is for a small moment. This is prophesying. This is of Jesus. For a small moment have I forsaken thee, but with great mercies will I gather thee. How long was that small moment? 3 days and three nights. Next verse. In a little wrath I hid my face from thee for a moment, but with everlasting kindness will I have hasid on thee. Covenant loyalty, saith the Lord thy Redeemer. Next verse. For this is as the waters of Noah unto me. For as I have sworn that the waters of Noah should no more go over there, so I have sworn that I will not be mad at you, wroth with you, nor rebuke you. God's not mad at you. But how many times do we do things thinking God is? Listen, he tells us to walk in covenant relationship because all that's outside of that is junk. All that's outside of that is destruction. But it's not God judging people. He already judged that in Jesus. How do you not get excited? Next verse, oh glory to God. For the mountains shall depart and the hills be removed, but my kindness shall not depart from me, neither shall the covenant of my peace be removed, saith the Lord that hath covenant loyalty on thee. But you don't understand what I did. No, you don't understand what he did. Back to Ephesians 2:14. just about ready to get into the new. For he is our peace. He is our peace. The Christmas season we proclaim, Luke chapter 2, verse 14, where the angels proclaim peace on earth at the birth of Jesus, goodwill toward men. But we look around and we hear of wars and rumors of wars. And then we read in Matthew 10, Jesus said, I didn't come to bring peace but a sword. What, do we got a contradiction? No, the peace he came to bring was a peace with God and man that you can experience through Jesus Christ, our peace. The better covenant built upon better promises. And it's sure, if you're not experiencing peace with God, if you're walking around in guilt and condemnation, you don't know him. That's good news. If you're the problem, you can be fixed. If he's the problem, he's the Lord and he changes not. He's our peace. Therefore, being justified by faith, Romans 5:1, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. Therefore, being justified by faith in him and the covenant, the new covenant, our representative Jesus, we're not trying to get it, we have peace with God. But I'm not experiencing this because you need to renew your mind. You need to be in church. This is why. You need to study to show yourself that he's approved you. Listen, you can walk in a curse. You can live in the morgue of the living dead. You can experience all the wrath and judgment that this world is experiencing because of rejecting Christ. And the Bible says, Jesus said in John 3:36, the wrath of God abides on those who don't believe. It's a judgment on a system that's rejected Christ. And it's going to culminate when Jesus returns. But you don't have to walk there. That's why we take communion. Amen. Communion's a covenant meal. Do this in remembrance. There's a covenant word. Remembrance of what? Well, to have crackers and juice. No! Of his body, what he did. The price was paid. Amen? Whew. Help me to communicate this, Lord. He is our peace. He's broken down the middle wall of partition between Jew and Gentile. These knuckleheads preaching the Jews got a relationship with God automatically because of natural lineage are clueless as two goose in the fog. I know that's not good English. That's ridiculous. Does Jesus love the Jew? Absolutely. And they can be born again just like a non-Jewish person and become part of the body of Christ. For he is not a Jew which is one outwardly, neither is that circumcision, there's a covenant word, which is outward in the flesh, but he is a Jew which is one inwardly, and circumcision is that of the heart and the spirit, whose praise is not of men, but of God, Romans 2:28 and 29. Glory to God. All right, let's get into this. Now go over to Ephesians 4:17 and 18. We looked at this last week. Look at this, Ephesians 4. This I say, therefore, and testify in the Lord. The Holy Spirit, through the Apostle Paul's talking to Christians, right? That you henceforth walk not as other Gentiles walk, those who don't know the Lord. Gentiles, ethnos, the nations walk in the vanity of their mind. You know what that is? Thinking I know something. Next verse.
Well, I'll tell you what, my idea is better than your idea. You know why? Why? Because my dad can beat up your dad.
Having the understanding darkened. The word understanding, look at the word. Thank you. The word understanding is dianoia. It literally means noia or nois is the word for mind. And dia contains, it's a preposition. It contains the idea of penetration. It's deep thought. Having their very, the deep thoughts darkened. Being alienated from the life of God through the ignorance that is in them because of the blindness of their heart. This understanding that they're darkened from is covenant understanding. They don't understand that. That's why, same book, we looked in Ephesians chapter 2. They're strangers from the covenants of promise, having no hope and without God in the world. This is why I'm telling you, this is why David spoke, 1 Chronicles 16:15, be mindful always of the covenant. And our covenant is being mindful of Jesus, because he's our representative. Now, with that said, we're talking about outside of the covenant, understanding believers will walk in the morgue of the living dead. Ephesians 2:1. This is new stuff. A morgue is a place, this is the definition, where bodies are kept, especially to be identified and claimed. You know, we all know what a morgue is, right? A morgue, that's what I define human religion as. It's a morgue because it neutralizes the body of Christ. You know, in Revelation 18, it talks about a religious system. And it says it's a habitation of devils and a hold of every unclean fowl and hateful bird. Whew! Religion is Satan's primary tool to promote deception. And he can't keep you and I from being born again, so his next goal is to neutralize us so we become ineffective. That's why the Bible warns, and America needs to hear this, of not being lovers of pleasures more than lovers of God, 2 Timothy 3. Because if you put pleasure, hedonism, or human pleasure, or creature comforts above him, guess who you're not putting in first place? Listen, and this isn't keeping rules. Just ask God. You have a relationship. You know, God will show you. He's not mad at you. He loves you, and he wants you to have fun. Amen. Charge them, therefore, that are rich in this world, that they be not high-minded, nor trust in uncertain, but in the living God who gives us richly all things to enjoy. God wants you to have fun. Just don't make it your God. Amen. Very simple. But see, most people, when God doesn't have your heart and then you get a little extra change, it's so easy to put that change in creature comfort and you spend your whole life in misery and you never fulfill your God-ordained plan for your life. Put him first and you'll have more fun accidentally than you ever did trying to on your in your own strength. Everything's better with Jesus in the center, including that four-wheeler. All right. Ephesians 2, and you hath he quickened or made alive. You know, it's been accurately said, and I love it. Jesus did not come to make bad people good, but to make dead people alive. You were dead in trespasses and sin. This Greek word for dead is nekros. One expositor says it literally means a walking corpse. Remember that movie years ago? Remember that Dawn of the Dead or something like that? I know you were probably praying when I was watching that. That's what I always tell my wife. I know, I didn't see that one. I'm sure I was doing something spiritual. You know, God is so unreligious, it ain't even funny. Amen. And you have been quickened, made alive. You were dead in trespasses and sin. Now, dead, we think of dead as, well, there they are. There's their body. And yes, physically, you'll drop your body someday unless the Lord physically returns before then. But dead just means separate from God. Remember, you can walk alienated from the life of God. You can be alive in him and walk separate from that. Hallelujah. God, I want to get into it. Next verse. Wherein in time past you walked according to the course of this world or age. The word according means you were dominated by the course of this age. According, once again, dominated by the prince of the power of the air. The spirit that now energizes or works in the children of disobedience. Next verse. Among whom we all also, we all had our, that word conversation is lifestyle, behavior. Old English, in times past, in the lust of our flesh, fulfilling the desires of the flesh and of the mind, and we were by nature the children of wrath, even as others. That's not who we are. Amen? That's why, once again, Proverbs 21:16, he that wanders out of the way of understanding shall remain in the congregation of the dead, the living dead, those who are operating disconnected from the life in God. That's why he's saying you've got to always be mindful that you've got a covenant with God through Jesus. Man, we're going to get into that. Man, that's so good. You know what that means? That means everything that Jesus has is yours. Everything. Everything. We sang a song today about the name of Jesus. You know how powerful that is? You know how amazing that is? Do you know that a wife can use the name of her husband and vice versa? Do you know that? Wow. All right, back to your outline. Go. What is a covenant? Let's do this. A covenant is a binding agreement between two parties to come together or agree. It's a binding obligation. I'm going to read this quick. A covenant is binding. It's unbreakable. It's an unbreakable obligation between two parties based upon unconditional love. Unconditional love. It's sealed by blood and sacred oath that creates a relationship in which each party is bound by specific undertaking on the other's behalf. Now, let me say this. In our position with Christ, Jesus represented us to the Father. He represents us. That's our position. But do you know our walk still matters? I've been saying this. You can walk in disagreement with the covenant that you have in Christ. Many do. See, this is why we come up with different forms of good works, and you got to do this and not do this and come to church so many times and get a badge or whatever we come up with. We come up with those things. This is why people don't understand confession. Because they think, well, I got a little book and says say it 8 million times and then somehow it'll work. No, you're saying it, you're acknowledging covenant. But if you don't know that, all you'll have is presumption. Now, watch this. So here, let me say this. Jesus said, if you love me, keep my commandments. Now, that's not talking about the Mosaic Law, the 613 commandments. This is why Jesus said in John 13, 34 and 35, a new commandment I give you. A new commandment I give you. Not an additional commandment. It's a new one. It's unique to a new covenant. That you love one another as I have loved you. By this shall all men know that you're my disciples, by your love one for another. Why is it a commandment? The word commandment is the Greek word entolai, and it means it's that which is prescribed to one by reason of his office. What is our office? Sons of God. And why are we commanded? Because if you don't walk in love with your brother and sister in Christ, you're walking in darkness and you're not even going to know what you're tripping over. We're going to get there. We're going to get there. Man, it's big. Man, it's big. Now, this doesn't mean you approve. See, we got this dumb, stupid, moronic, sorry. We got this foolish idea of what love is. Oh, love. Love, love, love. Go ahead, destroy your life. Love, love. Never counter anybody. That's not love. That's not love. Love is strong enough to say no to someone when it needs to. That's love. I guarantee if you love your kids and you're letting them play in the freeway, you don't love them. I don't want them to get mad at me. That's why they only eat candy. That's why they only eat candy all the time. You don't love them. You don't love them. Because love, covenant love, is not only love, it has to do with steadfastness, faithfulness, commitment, and strength. That's all part of covenant. Amen. So I'm saying all that to... I'm going there. Go to John 15. We got to see this. You got to see it. I've been saying it too much to not see it. John 15, just about done. We're going to at least get somewhere. we're doing actually good. This is so good. I'm telling you, this is life-changing. Amen. The more my heart sees this, the greater and more excited I get. Because I'm thinking, my word, am I blessed. I am where he is. He is where I am. We are one. You know, marriage, I was telling my wife, I was saying, you know, marriage doesn't say you're one spirit. It says you're one flesh. You know, and that's talking about Christ in the church, but yet it applies to marriage, Ephesians 5. Isn't that amazing? We're going to get into that. Man, that's good. But what did I say? I just had some verses up there. Yep, John 15, verse 12. We'll start with verse 12. Watch this. This is my commandment. This is amazing to me. That ye love one another as I have loved you. That's why it's a new commandment in John 13. As I have loved you. They couldn't do that under the old covenant. First of all, Jesus hadn't physically come, but they couldn't do that. But in this new covenant, you can. This is talking about your walk, not your position. Can Christians be carnal? Yes, most of them are. Next verse. Greater love hath no man than this, that a man lay down his life for my friends. Our American idea of friend is insane. Insane. I even heard a guy, he told me this. He said, well, I'll tell you what, my son can come and go in my refrigerator, but my friend can't. I think you do not know friend. I didn't know that at the time. Friend means, Abraham was called the friend of God. And when Jehoshaphat, I told you that, I was 2 Chronicles chapter 20, he appealed to Abraham, the friend of God, the one who's in covenant relationship. Can you prove that? Yes, you adulterers and adulteresses, know ye not that friendship with the world's way of doing things. What does it mean to be worldly? Outside of covenant with God. That's it. Forget these dumb ideas. Well, he was worldly. Those are dumb. He watched a movie about army men. That's worldly. That has nothing to do with being worldly. Worldly is just any time you operate out of covenant with God, and that's only through Jesus. Now watch this. You adulterers and adulteresses, James chapter 4. Know you not that friendship with the world, you make yourself the enemy of God? Whosoever therefore will be the friend of the world is the enemy of God. And he calls them adulterers and adulteresses. I don't know, that sounds like some different type of friend than what I'm used to. Hey, friend! Never see you again. See, friend's intimate. It's covenant talk. Just about done. Greater love hath no man than this, that a man lay down his life for his friends. What's a friend? Lay down your life. Does that mean you got to take a bullet? It might mean that. But it could just mean I'm going to put aside what I want for my friend. Think about Jesus, the Son of God in heaven, comes here, a body, goes through all the junk we go through. He says he was tempted in all points as you are. Man, that's love. God gives his only begotten Son because of love. I'm flying. Hang with me. Next verse. Here it is. You are my friends if you do. Well, that's old covenant. That was before the cross. No, that's new covenant. If you respond to me, you're my friends. You know we have a part in this covenant? Not to earn it, but to respond to it. See, you're not responsible for the light you don't have, but you are responsible for reaching for it. Dun, 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 dun. Right? You're my friends if you do whatsoever I command you. Next verse. Henceforth I call you not servants, for the servant knoweth not what his Lord doeth, but I have called you friends. Covenant talk. For all things that I have heard of my Father I have made known unto you. Next verse. You have not chosen me, but I have chosen you and ordained you that you should go and bring forth fruit and that your fruit should remain. Oh, I love this. That whatsoever you shall ask the Father in my name, he will give it you. Next verse. These things I command you that you love one another. Why is he saying that? Because the covenant don't work when I'm walking aside from it and in darkness. I don't have time to go to 1 John 1 and 2. That's why people teaching that 1 John chapter 1 is not for believers is insanity. And people I respect, it's wrong. So you start cutting up the Bible, the New Testament like that, you can do a lot of stuff. Intentionally or unintentional, it's wrong. All right, let me finish this. The parties of the covenant place themselves under the penalty of divine retribution should they later attempt to avoid the undertakings, those undertakings. In other words, if God was to violate his covenant, he would have to destroy himself. That's how strong it is. It is a relationship that can only be broken by death. Covenants are based upon blood. Covenants are based upon differences or weaknesses. Did you know that? Covenants are based upon weaknesses. How many of you know that when we're weak, he's strong? Amen. Now let me say this to you. We're responsible for what God shows us to do. And when we say, Lord, I can't do it, I don't have enough money, or I can't do this, or I'm not talking about presumptuous things. When God calls us, we're responsible to take those steps that way, right? But somebody says, well, God's part is to provide. That's his strength. You know what our strength is? The going. You know God can't go. Jesus had authority on this earth because he was the Son of Man, John 5:27, not the Son of God, even though he was that too. But he had to become a man in order to operate in this earth. You know the old saying, you're the only Jesus some people will ever see, is so true. That's why we got to understand these things. If we don't understand, listen, without covenant understanding, you don't understand the Bible. And I promise you that. I promise you that. My word, it is everywhere. All the sacrifices, everything are all hinged upon that. And to try to understand it. See, this is once again, this is why. Even Moses. Remember, he had his wife, Zipporah, Zippy, as she's been called. He had to circumcise her son. He says, you old bloody man. Why? Covenant. When covenant's broke, there's the only option is death. God has no choice. When people reject him, he has no choice but to send people to hell. He doesn't send them to hell. They choose to go there. But it's not an option. All right. Hang with me. So covenants are made. I talked about the key of David. I want to say one thing as I prep. Let me fly through a few of these things. His word is his covenant. Say his word is his covenant. Blessed is the man who truly knows God as a covenant God. Blessed is the man or woman, we're not being gender specific here, who knows God as a covenant God. Who knows God who cannot violate covenant. He cannot break his word. One more verse and then we're done. Psalm 89:34. Watch this. Here it is, to show you that his bond, his word is his covenant. Watch this. My covenant will I not break, nor alter the thing that has gone out of my lips. Imagine if the body of Christ operated like that. We would if we understood covenant. Because we would understand that my word is my covenant. It's my bond. And if I say it, I'm going to honor it. Psalm 15, verse 4 says, a just man will swear to his own hurt and change not. Well, what if I made a mistake? You remember the Gibeonites in Joshua chapter 9? God had commanded them to destroy these heathen nations, these idolaters. Why? Because it would affect them. But the Gibeonites faked it. And the Bible says, Joshua and Israel did not ask counsel from the Lord. Remember that? And so they made a covenant with them. And once they found out that they were their neighbors, they could not destroy them. Covenant cannot be violated. It can't be. And God's got a covenant with us. The sooner we understand that through Jesus, we have a covenant with him. Our level of commitment will rise to his level when we understand covenant. The flip side of that is if I'm not committed, that's the degree I don't understand it. I don't get it. So I just flip it with my words. My covenant will I not break, nor alter the things that flow out of my mouth. God wants us to operate just like him. That's why Ephesians chapter 5, verse 1 says, be imitators of God. Be imitators of how God operates. King James says followers, but it's imitators. Imitators. Imitate how God is. God's the covenant God. Blessed is the man or woman who knows God as a covenant God. Amen. It's got to land the plane. We're going to get a lot more.